And hello, and welcome to a new visual novel playthrough on this channel. Harmonia. A visual novel from Key, who, from my previous experience, are the people who made animes I really, really liked and watched before starting this channel, like Clannad, Angel Beats, or Little Busters. Sort of in the situation where I don't really have the opportunity to play those or experience them again in this. So, the option becomes potentially doing other stuff from them that I haven't seen. I haven't watched an anime from them for a long time. So there's lots of things I haven't tried from them, but some of the major ones are sort of out of there. I will note, as usual, this is a visual novel. It's not supposed to be a particularly long one either. From my understanding, somewhere between 8 to 11 hours in that range. It's not expensive either. I think it's around the day this goes up, there's a sale ending that has it for $5 on Steam. I'm willing to bet it's worth it. And as usual for visual novels, I highly, highly, highly recommend experiencing them first before watching any sort of Let's Play, as I would recommend with any game, so you can get the initial experience as well as try to relive it vicariously through people like myself. Highly recommend that. I'll never back off on that. I don't know much about this game. I know it's not very long. I know it's from Key. I really love their stuff simply because it's some of my favorite stuff out of the pure emotions that it drives from me. I don't know about their visual novels. I've never done one of their visual novels before. This is one of the excuses for me to do so. And I'm very interested what this will be about, because looking at this title screen, I don't really know what this is about. All I know is that it's in the range of time. So, you taught me how important feelings are. There's an everlasting song. Yet this background looks very weird. Sort of. Honestly, it looks like a bunch of toilets, but, you know. I don't know if there are choices in this, I don't know if there are different endings, I don't know anything else of that nature, so. With that said, let's begin. Began with an unnatural beep. A pale light suffused my vision. I first saw the light a few seconds prior. Or perhaps it was a few hundred years ago. Well, sounds like an operating table. Nothing else had changed much. I wondered when I started seeing that light. I wondered when I would stop seeing the light. Ideas flowed through my vague consciousness. I wondered how many times it had been. I wondered how many more times I would think these thoughts. Unconsciously, I extended my arm towards that pale light. Was something ending? That doesn't look like a proper hand. Was something beginning? It's like a robot hand. I didn't know, of course. Even so, I remain hopeful and continue to extend both arms towards the light. Oh, okay. Then the air moved. Well, this is different. The pale light which had once surrounded me began to recede, and the next thing I saw was a filthy, filthy ceiling. Both my right and left arms were extended towards said ceiling, but the right was a little bit different. My right arm was mechanical, and some components were poking out from the wrist. Does it look mechanical, or is it like a mechanical arm that's supposed to look natural, but you have, like, just, like, random parts, like, sticking out of the artificial skin? Or... My fingers moved smoothly, but as they did, I could hear the gentle reverberation of metal scraping against metal. Now I began to sit up. Slowly. Okay, is this me, then? Finally, I realized that the pale light which had consumed my vision came from the softly curved, oblong lid which was before me. Apparently, I had been asleep in this capsule-like thing. Where was I? Who was I? I don't know, man. Why was I here? Asking these questions to myself provided no answers. Yes, that's typically how it works. In an attempt to trace back my own memories, all I could recall was that pale light. Hoping to find even the smallest hint about my memories, I climbed down from the capsule and began to wander around the room. Even though I knew how to walk, I must not have done so for a long time. My legs were unsteady and shaky. Taking great care not to fall over, I slowly continued my walk. The air around me was lukewarm, and each breath I took coated my throat with dust. Yeah, this place does look a bit decrepit so far. An outside light was coming in through a hole in the ceiling, and its path revealed the dust in the air. It seemed as though no one had been in this building for quite some time. A thin layer of dust covered said floor. I wonder what went on in this place. I don't know, maybe they're replacing humans with mechanical parts. Especially if we only have one arm that's mechanical. Then again, it sounds like it's very explicit that it's mechanical, so... A countless number of those oblong capsules dotted the huge room. The majority of them were wide open. Meaning... most people had gotten out. Okay. My initial impression is that this seems like one of those, like, freezer storages. It mentioned something about hundreds of years, so... yeah. And they were all empty. Some of them were closed, but even they had nothing inside. It seemed as though I was the only one in the room. No, that wasn't exactly true. There are people leaning against the capsules and lying sprawled on the ground. Okay, that's a good sign. Except something was wrong. You couldn't really call them human. It might be more accurate to call them humanoid objects. The mechanical parts of these humanoid objects could be seen peeking out from beneath their skin. For some, everything above the neck was mechanical. The mechanical arms on some were bare. So is there some that don't have? I guess it's unclear. Are some of them like, are they cyborgs or are they androids? Some of the lower halves were torn and the mechanical parts visible. Then I remembered something about these humanoid objects. Fibroids? Sounds like a thyroid. Made for humans to serve as their partners. They were equipped not only with the five senses, but also emotions in order to be as close as possible to real humans. I reached out my hand to a motionless fibroid. That bare, skinless arm was frighteningly similar to my own. I understood. This was a factory. Really? Okay. I was made here. Just before I was completed, this place must have been destroyed for some reason. Before, my right hand was covered with artificial skin, staring at my mechanical arm. I reached this plausible conclusion. Realizing what I was, I began to walk towards a wall. There are old automatic doors with a dusty LCD reading closed next to them. I touch it with my mechanical hand, and just my bloodless fingertip, sent something cold and electrical, the display changed to read open, and the door is unsealed. Would I be able to get out this way? So, not because I touched... Oh, yeah, because I did touch it. Okay. I wonder if there's someone remaining within this facility. I wanted to meet them. I wanted to meet a human. To find my partner, I push the open door... I push open the doors leading outside, and set out in order to prove my own existence. Well, this is... not what I was expecting, but this is very interesting. Okay. Like, most of the stuff I've seen from them have been sort of like, you know, Klanon, Little Busters, Angel Beats, like, you know, school kids and stuff like that. In, like, the main, like, cast of people. But this is... I'm not complaining, it just... I didn't expect that. Nor did I really get that impression from, like, the little bit of art I saw when, like, buying it and whatnot. Once the human population hit its peak of 10 billion, a rapid decline began. Air pollution, water pollution, contamination, abnormal weather, and other conflicts. The list of causes was endless. During this time, the fibroids were developed. They were deeply emotional partners for humans. Fibroids were originally equipped with batteries, but... afterwards, an oral energy supply model was developed. Does this say something about me? Because I was not thinking, you know, eating food when I heard oral energy supply. I'm sorry. They could be powered by eating food. I did correct myself fairly quickly, though, when I had that thought come to mind. Fibroids became even more human-like as a result, eventually substituting for family or lifetime companions, and the demand continued to rise. Even more importantly, there was no such thing as death for fibroids. Therefore, they were able... and therefore, they're also in high demand in harsh work environments, such as hospice care and medicine. They could even be used in places which would be harmful for a human body. The fibroids were happy with this brutal work. After all, fibroids exist to live aside humans and to be needed by those same humans. As I reclaimed this knowledge from the depths of my memory, I walked across the cracked red earth. Having escaped that sand-covered facility, I was faced with a world that differed immensely from the one I knew. The wind swirled the dust around, interfering with both my sight and breathing. The earth I tread upon contained no trace of moisture, and each step created a small cloud of sand. The sky was covered with thick, all-consuming clouds, and I could not see a hint of bloom. This song's act... there's a lot of things I'm impressed with already by this. This song's quite good, too. It really emphasizes the, tone of the scene while also being... really sort of unique sounding. It's all, like, it's whimsical, yet it also sounds mysterious and maybe a little desperate. The sky was covered with thick, all-consuming clouds. I cannot see in a blue. It was so desolate a scene that it could not even be called a wasteland. As far as I could see, there's not a hint of a life, and not even plants grew here. It wasn't just that the facility I was in had been abandoned. Something had happened to this area. Well, I'm gonna go ahead and say human extinction to some extent. It's probably an answer. I came up with several possibilities as I scanned through my knowledge, but I found no answer. The occasional downpour would bring with it a rusty smell. In those cases, I took extreme care to make sure rainwater did not enter the glove, covering the exposed machinery of my right hand. I had found the glove in the factory. It fit my arm perfectly. Unfortunately, there's only the slightest bit of space for moisture to make its way inside. What's more, wearing the glove makes me look completely human. Well, I'm gonna go out on a limb and say that that probably doesn't really matter in this world. I'm willing to bet that the only things left alive are the thyroids. I want it to be just like a human. I suppose, yeah, emotionally. A sudden thought came to me in that moment. The glove was absolutely essential for that purpose. As I shielded myself from the murky raindrops, I consumed one of the emergency oral nutrient blocks that I had taken from the factory. As their only purpose was to efficiently supply energy, they were almost flavorless. At least they didn't flavor horrible. At least they're not horribly flavored. But regardless, they were necessary for me to keep taking steps forward. No matter how many steps I took, I did not find the light I was looking for. Judging from the changing brightness of the sky, I had walked for 3 days. Although I had reduced my walking speed to keep energy consumption down, I must have covered a fair distance, but I had not encountered a single human along the way. Nor did I encounter any towns, grass, or other living things. All that lay in front of my eyes was endless red brown earth. It was too harsh an environment to support any form of life. Was the world completely destroyed? Had humans become completely extinct? Was I the only thing that remained in this world? Seeds of doubt had been planted within me, and then finally began to sprout. However, I kept walking to dispel that doubt. I walked, walked, and walked, and walked. I don't know how far I walked. After all, to stop walking would be to lose my reason for existing. After the third squall, I arrived at a place with enough buildings to call a town. Abandoned too, I imagine. I was so sure I would find a human there. I quickened my steps and began to walk through the town. The town had grown old and all the buildings were badly weathered. All the metals were rusted and everything inside had rotten away. It must have been decades. No, it had been left untended for even longer than that, I thought. I didn't want to think about it, but I couldn't help myself. What if there wasn't a single human here? When my hope began to change to despair, I found myself in front of a store with an enormous showcase. The showcase's glass was broken, and all the goods it had once contained were missing. They had probably been stolen. As I looked over the showcase, I realized something. I see my reflection in the glass. I looked to be in my mid-teens. I was about 170 centimeters tall. Excluding my gloved right hand, I looked completely human. Although it was hard to call that expression on my face human. Completely transparent and inorganic. In no way could it truly be called an expression. It looked human-like, yes, but it was quite far from human. This is what I saw reflected in the glass. But if you are at a point where you can see your expression and be like, yeah, that doesn't really have any emotion to it, that doesn't look human, you're probably closer to human than you give yourself credit for, basically. There was no expression. Just like a regular old robot. Only something meant to do work, a machine without a soul. You're also a teen, so I don't think you're made to do work, at the very least. I definitely don't think you're made for that purpose. Like, machine or not machine, they're gonna give you, like, if you're gonna be made to do work, you can be made specialized for that. They're gonna give you, like, the equivalent of muscles, and you're probably gonna look more muscular, and stuff like that. No, I'm just saying. A machine without a soul. But I was a thyroid. Acknowledging my lack of emotions would prove that I was defective. Well, expressiveness isn't emotions. You seem pretty emotional at this point, so I'm just saying. And that was unacceptable. Despite being made to be a human's partner, I could never fulfill that role. Purpose of life, eh? If that were the case, my existence was without merit. Having been activated, I wanted to be useful for humans. However, I'd probably need emotions if I were to do so. If I could learn emotions. If I could do that, I would be able to return to an existence worthy of a thyroid. If I met humans, I would surely learn emotions. There is no doubt about it. So, I had to find humans. I had to find someone soon and actually talk with them. I guess it's pretty hard to properly imagine. I left the town, having given up apparently, and continued walking. I was driven by an instinct much like a sense of duty to meet a human. The degree of brightness in the gray sky quietly began to shift. No matter how far I walked, no matter how far I proceeded, nothing changed. Desolate earth as far as the eye could see. There's no shred of hope. Despite this, I walked. I walked to rid myself of the worry. I don't know how many days passed. I just kept on walking. I eventually reached the end of the supply of ore nutrient blocks I had taken from the factory. Despite this, I continued walking. Then, I noticed my knees were on the ground. Ooh. That's not good. My body would not accept the simple command to move my legs forward. I looked at my surroundings. Still nothing but the unchanged barren lands. The gray cloud sky and the dry, stagnant wind. Have all the humans been truly wiped out? So then I... My vision gradually dimmed. And the world in front of my eyes began to lose its color and slowly went dark. And then I collapsed face down into the reddish brown earth. And I lost consciousness. And the next thing I saw, once again, was a ceiling. However, this ceiling wasn't cold like the one at the facility I'd been activated in. Ooh, someone save me. Although it had stains, likely due to its age, there was a kind of softness in the white walls and wooden beams that supported them. Where was I? We're in a house, so... Someone found me. Despite being out in the middle of fucking nowhere, but okay. Why was I here? Turning my head to the side, I saw desk shelves and the bed I was lying upon. The bed, which was gently supporting me, was quite soft and had a sweet smell. I knew I had fallen on that devastated earth and lost consciousness. Did that mean someone had carried me to this place? Could it have been that I was carried by? As the thought passed through my head, I heard a noise. It was a small sound, almost small enough to miss. But I heard it. Putting my trust in that sound, I left the room. Well, if there's someone here, I would have found them. Eventually, I followed the hallway that continued outside the door and the sound grew louder. It was a voice with a mixture of certain rhythm and intonation. A form of expression that humans called song. It was also somewhat nostalgic. It was also a somewhat nostalgic singing voice. But I had no memory of ever hearing it before. In fact, I did not have any memories to begin with. But somehow, it felt nostalgic all the same. Then I began to feel a slight warmth spread through my body. Feeling a warm sensation from a song was a strange thing. Very strange. I knew it should be strange, and yet, what was it I was feeling? There was a warmth deep within my chest. Before I knew it, my feet were leading me towards the singing voice. The voice guided me to a big white door. The voice was then the loudest it had been. The owner of the voice was clearly beyond this door. laying my hands upon it, I slowly open the door. On the other side of the door lay a chapel. Really, okay. It was an open space. Benches were evenly spaced throughout. There were multicolored stained glass. The singer was standing amidst the light that poured through the window. Hands together as if in prayer was a lone human girl, singing that strangely nostalgic melody. Somehow her warm voice had completely stopped my thinking. I simply stood there, lending my ear to the girl's song. Finishing singing, the human girl slowly turned my way and smiled.
Okay.
Okay. That's maybe not how I describe this place, but okay. Welcome home. I replied without thinking, and the girl let out an embarrassed laugh. That would explain it. I look like your brother. You didn't accidentally save me and leave him out there to die, did you?
What color?
Was I orange? I don't remember being orange. Orange. Power. What do you mean? She attempts to explain it with gestures, but I did not understand. As I mulled over what she was saying, she gave me a small laugh. She continued to smile as she walked towards me. Do I get a name? Well, I'm... The truth is, I do not remember anything. Where I am from, who I am, I just don't know. Half truth, half lie.
そっか、 大変だったね。 だからあんなところで倒れてたんだ。
You help me then, Shiona.
うん、そうだよ。 青い顔してゲソゲソってしてたからびっくりしたよ。
So, it was you. Thank you, Shiona.
いいの。元気になってくれて嬉しいよ。 名前は…
Don't name me after your brother. Don't name me after your brother. Sorry, but I just cannot remember it.
そっか。 だったら、私が名前をつけてあげるよ。
Well, you can make a nickname for me. You don't necessarily have to name… Well, okay, fine. I suppose he doesn't really have a name, technically, so… So you're going to name me, then?
だって、呼ぶとき困るでしょ?何がいいかな?かっこいい名前がいいな。
What? No, can I choose? I want to be Echo. Shiona began to mumble, considering the this name and that name. Then…
決めたよ!
With a delighted smile on her face, Shiona took a step towards me.
Rei! でどう? 青くてシュッとしててかっこいい名前でしょ?
I've heard worse. I don't know about a bite, but it is a good name. What does it mean?
黎明の文字を取って、黎だよ。 お兄ちゃんが好きな言葉だったの。
Light. Interesting. I did notice when I was doing the settings for this, there were three different characters that you could set voices for. Two girls and like one older gentleman. I think he had a beard, basically. Your brother. Looks outside again. I think he may be up against impossible odds. The meaning of dawn was clearly the end of night. It felt like a fitting name for me, as I had just been activated. What is your brother like?
いろんな音楽を作っていたのよ。
Like what?
赤い曲、丸い曲、熱い曲。私は白とかオレンジが好きだったな。
Do you have... What's the condition? I'm forgetting what the name is, but it's like the condition where you can like experience certain senses with your other senses. So like you can like hear music and experience a color, that sort of thing. You have something like that, maybe? I'm sorry, I do not understand. Shiona said with an embarrassed smile. I don't really understand, but I do really like the name. Thank you, Shiona. I shook her extended left hand. It was soft and warm. Okay. So, question. I have so many questions. Can you answer them? Hold on, Shiona. I need to be leaving. Wait. I found it. Wait, what? My whole thing was I need to find a human. I need to find a human. I need to find a human. Find a human. Or some, or at least someone I think's a human. I no guarantee, you know? Fine. And it's just like, nope. Get in out of here. This is too real. This is too real. Well, I had not thought about what I was going to say next. I wanted to help humans. But now, all I could do was cause trouble. If I were any more of a bother, my existence would be without value.
Hey, 困っている時はお互い様だよ。それに…
Shiona turned to look at the chapel. She looked incredibly small compared to its vastness.
一人でここにいるのは寂しいの。よかったらここにいてくれないかな?
Oh, it's like you read my mind. As to why I was so… perplexed by the situation, or, you know, since there was a human right there who wanted that, I had no reason to deny her request. Shiona saved me. She gave me a name. But was there anything I could do for her? I wanted to give something back to her. If my being here could be in any way to pay her back. Alright. Thank you, Shiona. I would do just that then. Shiona's expression suddenly relaxed.
嬉しいな。とってもとっても嬉しいな。心の中が丸くてオレンジ色だよ。
Okay. Taking over my left hand, Shiona shook it over and over.
よろしくね。これからとってもとってもよろしくね。
Quite possibly. Then again, if it was just...A, you know, I suppose it could be. It wouldn't be unheard of for it to just be a simple, nice story where people, like, emotionally become supportive of one another and help each other through their emotional problems. It could be that. It could be. Maybe. Possibly. Maybe. No, I'm thinking probably not. Yeah. I saw Shiona smile up close. I realized I wanted to be able to see that smile close by all the time.I felt like I could watch her smile forever. So we want to protect that smile, basically. But to that end, there was something I wanted to do. Specifically, to return my emotional functions to normal. That was necessary in order to be a partner. But even more than that, I stared at Shiona's face. Upon it was the emotion I wanted most. I absolutely had to obtain that emotion.I wanted to help keep Shiona smiling. Always. I made my decision in secret. Suddenly, my stomach rumbled. Okay, one sec. You know, I don't really know what these do. I assume this is skip and this is auto. This is log. Is there a, Okay, we do have a menu. Okay. Where I can save and all that sort of stuff. Okay. What I wanted to do is...I had adjusted the sound where sound effects were pretty low and I could barely hear that grumble, so... Pr- probably a bit excessive for how far I put it down. So, let us continue. Suddenly, my stomach rumbled. This was natural, since I hadn't eaten anything after running out of oral nutrient blocks, which was probably a big part of why I, you know, collapsed.
もしかして、お腹空いてる?
Yes, I am. I haven't eaten anything for a long time.
そっか。お腹ペコペコだと気分が青くなっちゃうよね。わかるわかる。
My feelings turn blue. Okay, maybe not the person to best understand emotions by emulating. I'm just gonna say that right here. I had no knowledge of such an expression. Perhaps it was a manner of speech unique to her. I was at a loss for words, and then Shiona took my hand. But what if I don't want to feel orange? What if I want to feel yellow? Gosh darn it, Shiona. We left the chapel, with Shiona pulling me by the hand. Going down a white hallway, she led me to the kitchen. A delicious smell from origin unknown began to tickle my nose. There we go. Yeah, that's a bit more audible. My stomach rumbled loudly, crying out with desire. Shiona took an apron off a nearby wall and put it on. Shiona's own sweet smell began to merge with the one of cooking that had soaked into the apron.
さてと、ご注文は何にいたしますか?
Shiona had begun playing the role of a chef. Do you really have ingredients enough in order to make just whatever you want? This all feels a bit too ideal here, doesn't it? It makes you sort of suspicious. Anything that I can put into my stomach would be good. Do you have any rice? I'd love some rice. They taste great.
ダメダメ、レイ。こういう時は、おすすめは?って聞くものだよ?
So you don't actually want what I want. Okay. I would? Okay.
そしたら私が、ほわわっと温かな気持ちになれて、料理がより美味しくなるの。Shiona
smiled, pressing both hands against her chest. Okay. So, what do you recommend? I repeated the word she had taught me.
はい。本日のおすすめはですね、オレンジ色のポワポワするスープです。
Are you messing with me? This is clearly a unique verbal expression. I had no idea what she meant, but it sounded like it would warm me up. Okay then, I'll have that soup.
かしこまりました。座って待っててね。
We already had the discussion over that not making sense to me. Come on. Whatever. Shiona pointed to a chair at a nearby table. Power, power. Power, 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 power you. As I sat down, Shiona began to hum and cook. It was that same song again. The song she sang at the chapel. That warm, nostalgic feeling. What would nostalgia's color probably be? Blue? No, not blue would be sadness, right? Red would probably be anger. Orange is probably happiness or excitement, something like that. Like it makes you energetic. Maybe yellow is bright, warm, happy. Green could be smooth, sort of a very... Well, you usually associate green with like jealousy, right? So, I guess I'm at the point where I'm wondering, like, maybe she's just... Maybe she's the same way as Ray here, basically. She seems human, but I wouldn't bet on anyone we meet actually being human. Maybe she's the same way as Ray, where she had no emotions and she learned them by basically interpreting the emotions by associating them with the hints of feelings that you get when you look at certain colors. Because, you know, there are research and stuff to demonstrate... Because, you know, there's research out there that demonstrates that you are more inclined to certain emotions when you look at certain colors, that sort of thing. That idea. And if yellow is happiness, then her bright yellow hair, I'm just saying. I felt as though I had heard that song somewhere before. I began to hear the nice rhythmic sound of the kitchen knife. It merged with Shion's song, almost like it was a concert performance. Feeling no other desire than to hear the song for the rest of my days, I sat back and soaked it in. She began putting the ingredients into the oil pot. Suddenly, a rich fragrance began to envelop the room. As the scent became stronger, my stomach began to growl more and more. She wasn't cooking for herself, she was cooking for me. It wasn't going to benefit her. Is this how humans act? But then I realized something. At that moment, I was simply being entertained by Shiona. I wanted to be a partner. I wanted to be useful. Didn't I just decide that I wanted to be useful? Can't I be useful to Shiona somehow? Wasn't there something I could do to make her happy? I stood up from the chair and spoke to Shiona's back as she cooked. Shiona, is there anything I can do?
Suruko? Naiyo? Suwatte ryori ga dekiru no matteite.
I can't just sit here and have you cook for me. Anything's fine. I just want to help.
So da ne. Heya no souji nante dou kana?
Cleaning. That had a good sound to it. It sounded really helpful. Okay, cleaning. Where should I clean?
Kono heya no tonari ni living ga aru no. Soko o souji shite kureru?
Why does she strike me as someone who doesn't really make a mess in the first place? Ashina points towards the door with her ladle. Got it. I'll take care of it while you are cooking. Yeah, this doesn't look messy for sure. I entered the door she had pointed and went into the living room. As I did, an herbal smell wafted to my nose. I took several deep breaths to try to determine its source. As I did, I began to look over the room. The living room was completely organized. Not an unnecessary item to be found. The floor, the walls, and everything within the room was kept well clean. Could it be that it had already been clean? No, there had been some part that had not been cleaned yet. Shiona had asked me to go clean, after all. I picked up the duster in the corner of the room and began to clean. The table, the sofa, the decorative plants, and the top of the shelves. I dusted every single thing that was in the living room. Dust went flying around as I worked, and the candle holders hanging from the ceiling. So it wasn't that clean. Evidently, Shiona's height prevented her from reaching some places. I continued to dust the higher locations. Each time I sent dust flying, I felt that I was being useful. As I continued, the dust began to pile up on the table and shelves. I exchanged the duster for a broom the size of my palm and began to collect the dust. Then something happened as I was cleaning one of the shelves. My eyes came into contact with a picture of one of them. It was a picture of Shiona. Shiona and a lone man. I felt as though I had seen that man somewhere before. I had. In the showcase glass of that town, my own image? Oh, which meant that this man was Shiona's older brother. Although we did look similar, there were some clear differences. Okay. I do really look like him. Good. Okay. For a second there, I was like, whoa, what the fuck does this mean? The man in the photo had an expression on his face that I had never seen before. Next to Shiona's bright smile, he looks worried and irritated, but was smiling all the same. A variety of emotions mingled within his expression. Is this what she meant by brusqueness? I didn't quite know what emotions were captured in this photo of her brother, but it did express how well they got along as siblings. I touched my own face as I looked at the photo. I traced my cheeks, pulled on the ends of my eyebrows, and pushed in the corners of my mouth. I wondered what I could do to make that expression. if I could understand feelings, would I be able to naturally produce that kind of expression? Well, I personally hope that we don't suddenly start trying to become her brother, because that would not be great. Like, a replacement. I figured the quickest way to fix these broken emotions was to come into contact with as many different kinds of emotion as possible. I recalled that human children learn emotions by mimicking their parents' expressions. So if I also came into contact with a variety of emotions and emulated them, then, because even if the outside world was fine, it would be a lie if the inside was not. No matter how you patch up a fake, the lie within will show through. First, if I did not learn to experience joy and pleasure from within, I would not be able to smile. I need to be helpful to Shiona. Saying her smile would surely lead me to joy. I resumed cleaning. Next, I stumbled across a cubicle object. It was a box with a handle on it. It was big enough that it required both my hands to hold it. I love music boxes. There's a lot of interesting things going on in this so far. And it always never fails. It always feels like whenever I do multiple series, there's something between them that's like, just like a significant parallel. I'm playing Nier Automata at the moment on the channel as well. I won't note. And there's some obvious parallels to this, basically. With the Android thing and everything is the biggest thing, obviously. I remember other series where it's like, you had like a very significant dog, like within episodes of each other going up, that sort of thing. Or like a dog character, that sort of thing. Played a similar role, or stuff about like professions, or I'm gonna say archery has been one that's come up. Like, it partly is just because of the fact that there's a lot of tropes that are reused and used in different ways, so they pop up if I play games from similar cultures, you know, Japanese stuff and whatnot. So it's very interesting to see how some of these things parallel. But in music boxes, I suppose that's just one of the things, like in my life, if there's anything that I would describe as the most nostalgic, most, like, thing that, like, I'm not a sentimental person. I am not. In the slightest. But if there's one thing that typically makes me sentimental, it would be a music box. Including the one I own, in particular. And what was it? I opened the lid. A gold disc-like object was inside. What was this disc? I tried turning the handle, but nothing happened. The handle spun meaninglessly without any resistance.
Rei, dekita yo.
Shiona had opened the door and come inside, bringing the smell of cooking with her. Once the smell had hit my nose, I grunted involuntarily.
Sugoku kirei ni natta ne, Rei.
Had I finished? I don't think I had. As she looked over the room, a smile came to Shiona's face. You're really indulging him, aren't you? Thank you. Those words satisfied something deep within me. But I did not know what that was. Looking at my hands, she cocked her head to the side. It was the wooden box with the handle that did nothing when it was cranked. Shiona, what is this? She took the box from me and opened up the lid. Inside was a round metal plate with irregular protrusions on its surface. Shiona began to turn the handle sticking out of the wooden box, but nothing in particular happened. Only the handle was spinning. That was all.
Man, this almost
makes me want to go. Where did I put that music box? I like almost want to go find it right now. Since the disc inside wasn't spinning, it wouldn't make a sound. So, it is broken. I can be helpful by fixing it. Echo wants you to fix it, Rei. I want the music box to work. Let's do it. Shiona touched the disc, a sad smile forming on her face.
This is the disc that's in your music.
your brothers. Was that that song that you were singing? It cannot be fixed. Let's go this way. So, when he was looking at the, this will probably be easier. I'm playing this on a controller, technically. I set it up so a lot of the stuff can be done through that. But it's slower on a mouse wheel, basically. So, the picture of the brother. He said that it was different, but was that just the... an expression. So all he said was that the only actual difference he noted was an expression. Which means that her brother probably looks just like him, which means her brother, end quote, is probably straight up just another model of him, basically. One from before, essentially. Okay. It's okay for it to stay broken. Was that really enough for her? I wanted to fix my broken emotions. Leaving things broken seemed incredibly inefficient, but Shiona was ready to leave the music box as it was. I just couldn't understand that at all. Shiona put the music box back in its place and looked back at me with a smile. This is either going to be horrible or amazing. Shiona led me back to the kitchen. We left the broken music box behind. Oh, let's fix it. Come on, I want to fix it. The soup was sitting atop the table. Heat was rising from it, and a pleasant smell began to caress my nose. However, its color was in no way orange. Shiona sat down in a chair and collapsed her hands together in front of her face. Okay. An observation of just being like in the corner there. How, you see a big hole in the wall with cracks and whatnot. So this place isn't without that. It seemed like it was in pretty darn good condition. There haven't been a whole lot of signs of just like it falling apart. Shiona sat down in a chair and collapsed her hands together in front of her face, already moving to start putting the soup in my mouth. I hurried to mimic Shiona. Did we really need all that? Okay. After her prayer was over, Shiona smiled at me. I should actually read if there's anything. I'm not religious, so I have no idea if that's just a normal prayer, if there's something, like, hidden in there. So, in terms of, like, foreshadowing or stuff like that. Okay, thank you. I dipped my spoon into the soup and brought it to my mouth. The warm liquid spread out, permeating inside my cheeks and tongue. Just an instant later, the aroma of vegetables began to hit my nostrils. This was nothing like the Oreo nutrient rations. It had stimulating tastes and smells. So, this was food. I suppose your first food ever would always taste pretty good if it was, you know, not just complete horseshit. As soon as the soup had passed down my throat, I brought up a second spoonful.
Hey, do? Oishii?
It's delicious. Very much so. As though I was soothing a parched throat, I brought the soup to my mouth time and time again. Similarly, I took the bread, piled upon the plate, and ripped off pieces, shoving it into my mouth. She innocently watched me eat, without even laying a finger on her own soup. Apparently. But my hands won't stop. I forgot about talking to Shiona and just focused intensely on putting the food in front of my face, in front of me into my body. I placed my dish into Shiona's outstretched hand. Please. With a little bit of a joking tone to her voice, Shiona went to the soup pot. But why was she calling the soup orange? Pawa was an onomatopoeia, so I kind of understood it. But when you eat warm things, you get warm. It was the warm, toasty sensation. Pawa. Okay. Understandable. But why orange?
Hi. Dozo.
I was thinking all this while looking at the milky white soup Shiona had placed in front of me. Shiona, why do you call this soup orange? It's white, isn't it? Yes, I think that's why I asked the question. Shiona said with a slightly impish smile. I really would. Please tell me. Teasing me, Shiona put a spoonful of soup into her mouth. Yes, my body feels really warm. And that's why you call it Pawa, correct? Shiona placed a hand on her chest. Slowly, she closed her eyes. I suppose I'd see orange more as energetic, but okay. Maybe yellow is the energetic one here. I don't know. Deep inside my soul. Following her lead, I placed my own hand on my chest. However, all I could feel were the parts necessary for my life functions. Shiona laughed. But I still didn't understand what she was saying. I wonder if it was because my emotions were still broken. Or maybe I... take my mind off of it, I continued to pour the soup into my body. But I never felt any orange feeling. Shiona asked this, as I was draining the rest of the soup from the bowl. My stomach was indeed full, physically. Yes, completely full.
So, you got that. Ne, Rei, onegai ga aru ndakedo.
Yes. I had a strong reaction to what she said. Asking me to do something she wants me to be useful, which makes it almost like an order. Shiona was asking me to help her. What? Of course, leave it to me. What do you mean by? If I was helping Shiona, then that could mean my existence had meaning. Wait, you buy things from what? What are you going to buy? Is there actually a community around? I suppose you're probably not you could have been growing it yourself. Where are you going to shop? Okay. Got it. Well, let us go then. I was not sure. But apparently it was. Wasn't? I don't really think it's that big of a deal. There's a lot of myths involving stuff like that. We decided to wait an hour before going, and spent the time relaxing after our meal. Okay, time to see this rumored civilization, including a store! Exactly 1 hour later. We left to go do some shopping. The outside air was dusty, and it made each breath hurt the back of my throat. The air was so laden with dust and grit that it occasionally got in my eyes. The sky was filled with thick black clouds without a hint of bloom. It seemed Shiona's home in the church was actually on the outskirts of the town. The same town that we had exited before. Since then, walking a bit from the house, a vast expanse of reddish earth could be seen. Now that I think of it, were you the one who carried me after I had collapsed? Stuff about this strikes me as suspicious, but okay, carry on. Ah, well, I was hungry while walking, and then I just went down, I guess. But how exactly did you find me anyway? Did you have any reason to be out there at all? Okay. So you just found me by accident, while you were throwing your trash away. Maybe we'll be back there someday. I couldn't make heads or tails of it. After walking a bit, houses and shops started appearing. It started to look like a town. As we walked, the number of people steadily increased, compared to the total absence earlier. That... did I just get really unlucky? Shiona started talking to an elderly man.
Oh, it isn't Shiona. Hello. You always look beautiful.
Yeah,
you've been working great since you polished the lenses. It's a good thing that that young boy also made a good recovery. Please polish them again if my eyes get worse, okay?
I started thinking as soon as we left the old man. Was I that young boy he was talking about? And then someone called up to Shiona. Oh, was that you, Shiona? This time was a woman. A human middle-aged woman. She was a lot bigger than Shiona. Way better than before. You really saved me back there. Thank you. Thanks. I appreciate it. I'm glad that young boy's feeling better. Hey everyone, Shiona's here. As soon as the larger, middle-aged woman raised her voice, a swarm of children gathered. I suppose they could be human. It's Shiona!
Shiona!
Can I come over for soup again? Your soup is good. Let's go tomorrow. I'm glad he's feeling better. Me too.
Me three.
Shiona kept smiling at them. As they saw her face, they returned her smiles with their own. I just gazed at her from the side. I felt as though I could look at that smile forever. I guess that young boy is feeling better, huh? Again, someone called out to her. It was a respectable-looking man with a stiff posture. He was holding a camera.
That was
nothing, really. I just wanted to be of assistance. Shiona was adored by these people. They didn't think twice about wanting to help her. I'm glad he's feeling better after that. So, what do you think? How about I take a photo to commemorate your recovery? A photograph. I thought of the picture in the living room. In it, Shiona was standing next to her brother. I imagined myself in his place. And somehow found myself wanting a photo like that. Alright, if it's okay. I stood next to Shiona in the stream. The photographer aimed his camera and moved a lever with his right hand. I hear the sound of something being wound. Shiona, What is that sound? Film. The cameras I knew about had optical lenses, where the scenery is saved in digital form. Analog devices and exposure material like film and photos were projected onto, were things I only knew about academically. Well, you only know everything academically, technically, but okay. I knew it was a system from a past era, and that the process was called developing took a lot of time and effort. It was also highly inefficient. Why can he not take digital photos?
Digital is using light, so...
Well, very convenient that I can replenish my energy with food, then. That's right. The photo in Shiona's house was on paper. I guess the energy supplies had changed since the world I knew existed. Or maybe it was just this town. While thinking that, I looked towards the camera lens in front of me. The photographer had plenty of time to take the photo, but he had not moved at all. Actually, he furrowed his eyebrows. Ah, you're too far apart. Move closer together, please. There was an unnatural space between me and Shiona. As I was fixed on the photographer, on what the photographer said, Shiona smiled and closed the space between us. I felt a great warmth when our skin touched. Alright, here we go. Say cheese! I still couldn't manage to smile. But of course, I was sure Shiona had no problem smiling. I knew even without looking at her. Okay, you're done. Now send the photo when it's finished. After saying our thanks, we headed off towards our destination. Then, on the way, we passed into the town plaza. But there weren't too many people there. I felt like they made a mistake calling this place a plaza. What do you mean before? Before this apocalypse, or was there an era in this town prior, or after the apocalypse, but it had changed since then? It does seem like it has been long enough that could be possible. She had a smile with certain sadness. She didn't have to say why, I already knew. It was obviously tied to the diminished population. Okay. But if we're assuming if we're assuming she is human, then we shouldn't assume that she was there when, you know, before whatever happened, right? That, or suppose the population could have went down in her lifetime. Although if she's human, she's in her teens, which means this has been hundreds of years of collapse. If there's a significant population diminishment over the course of like the past 10 years, that would probably be the extent of her memory of this sort of thing. Then that would be pretty significant in its own way. I'm just saying. Basically, I'm not trusting the idea that anyone we meet is human. So I'm gonna go ahead and find confirmation bias in anything that seems to suggest that. For someone like, say, her. Honestly, I don't think it matters if they're human or not. I think that's probably the point, but you know. Is it because of the dirty air? Scared of what? Okay. She is making an argument for me being, you know, full of bullshit. Thanks, Shiona. My speculation goes down the drain when you, like, contradict the possibility a little bit. Or contradict it as evidence, at the very least. No, I did not know then. What type of assault? Is it that bad? That's unfortunate. For water. The post-apocalypse and water issues. Name a more fitting bear. I recall the barren land I walked on before reaching this town. It seemed like the place still had a clean water source. Somehow. And of course, there would also be humans going after that. So, limited resources led to conflicts. I suppose I don't need water, right? That's a good point, right? Because I had the nutrient packs, not water, and all that stuff. Maybe that was part of the problem. So, limited resources lead to conflict. She only responded with a mournful laugh. I didn't know when those times referred to for Shiona. I did not know when those times referred to for Shiona, but I understood the idea. There was a lonely expression on Shiona's face. I felt certain that during those times, Shiona had never made this face. If we could restore those times, maybe Shiona would smile forever. But if that was the case, what could I do to help? There was no way for me to answer that question at this time. After hearing her voice, I realized we had arrived at the shop. Compared to the surrounding buildings, this shop seems abnormally old. The obviously handwritten mad shop sign made the shop's condition clear. It was dark inside and difficult to see in. Shiona, is this the shop? Seems like the exact sort of place that would get burgled pretty regularly in this sort of, environment. Try as I might, I just couldn't see what she was talking about. The atmosphere is fitting for monsters or something to have been living inside. Hey, Shiona. What kind of person is this mad fellow anyways? While that seemed like something she would say, I got a really bad feeling from it. But there was no turning back. I made up my mind and stepped into the shop. Inside was very dimly lit as I had seen from outside. The inside was coated in dust. It seemed like it had not been cleaned in a long time. Oh, I could just imagine how, it seems like they probably have supplies that are possibly going to be sold in 5-10 years' time, sort of thing. So, especially if they have everything, heavy tools and all that sort of stuff. Just sort of, like, collect as much as you can and, you know, keep it for sale as long as you can until someone needs it. It was completely different from Shiona's house. Even the food and items on the shelves were covered in a thin layer of dust. Oh, okay. Was he seriously running a shop like this? It seemed wrong.
Mato-san, konnichiwa. Konnichiwa.
Nobody seemed to answer Shiona's call.
Rusana no kana? Okashii na.
Right where Shiona pointed was a chair, next to the cash register. The chair had a slight bend to it, which gave a hint to how big Mad was. Shiona, is it okay to just enter like this? I went along with it and walked inside. I'm more concerned about the fact that he seems to leave this place unattended to. Friend or no, with Shiona, there's lots more people than us. Maybe I just grew up in an environment where I wasn't so trusting. Especially looking at this environment and thinking, like, why would you be so trusting in this environment, too? I'm sure there's plenty of nice people around, but it seems like there'd be plenty of, like, desperate people around, too. Well. There are a lot of food items in the front, but traveling towards the back, there was much, much more. From writing utensils, tools, the machine parts, it seemed as if he just picked up these things and put them on display. There are even broken things on display and several things I wasn't sure were for sale. It really looked like scrap yarn. However, one thing did catch my eye. On top of something like a disc, there were these strange moving needles. It seemed like it would fit perfectly in my hands. I knew what it was, of course, but it was the first time I had seen one. Like a record player? Oh, a clock, okay. It was an analog tool for telling time, made from an uncountable number of gears, inspired by electricity, or at the very least a spring. A tool to tell time, without a doubt. The digital versions were far superior. There is a certain elegance to clockwork, though. Something you can't quite replicate in any other fashion. Especially super high quality clockwork. All that stuff's cool. They receive waves from satellites or from all over the world that allow for perfect timekeeping. Yeah, atomic clocks. Woo! More than anything, analog devices were subject to a lot of imprecise elements, and the slight pull of Earth's gravity also affected them. Which is why using analog clocks would give you inaccurate times. Well, overtime at the very least. But that was the kind of clock that was hanging there. Was it for sale? Like, I'm there like, man, that's a clock, it's analog, it's so bad in comparison to the, like, possible options. I want it. Is he selling it? Curious, I sent my hand toward the clock. It was lighter than I expected. The second hand was moving steadily. A spring mechanism protruded from the back. So it didn't need electricity, and this clock was moving solely due to the spring apparatus. I wanted the spring. Crank, crank. I felt the spring inside the clock being wound up. Felt like I was breathing. It felt like I was breathing life into the device. Then something happened. Oh, that doesn't sound good. I made a dull noise in my hands. That didn't sound good. It probably shouldn't have made that noise. Just like that, the steadily moving second hand stopped cold. I hardly tried to wind the spring again. Suddenly I heard a crunch, and after that the spring wouldn't turn.
Kisama! Nani wo shiteru nda?
Great question. Like a thunderclap, a booming voice from behind me startled me. Turning around, I saw a large, enraged guy standing there. His face was beet red.
Sono te.
Yeah, I agree. It is in my hands. He was so angry that he couldn't get the words out. He pointed to the clock in my hands. This had to be mad. He kept his sharp eyes fixed on me. Yeah, okay, this is the older-looking gentleman. Yeah, and he has a voice, so... yay. This? Looking to Mad's eyes... I was unable to speak. It was like he was already strangling me. I prepared myself for my ends. My legs shivered. I couldn't move an inch. I hope not. Did I break it? Could I have possibly touched such a thing? While I considered this, he loomed forward with a giant step and violently grabbed my collar. His rough fists were pushing into my throat. I could hardly breathe. The clock in my hands fell to the ground. I could hear the crash of the delicate metal parts flying in all directions.
Shemek!
Okay, that part's probably on you, man. Gripping my collar, he dragged me through the store. Due to our difference in height, I had to try my best just to touch the ground. Of course, I couldn't put up any fight.
Ore no mise kara dete ka!
Well... that ended well, and upon saying that, he threw me right out of the shop. For an instant, I was floating through the air. I ended up landing directly on my back. For a few seconds, I lost consciousness and even stopped breathing. I could make out the glaring visage of Mad staring me down from within my upside-down view of the world. That ended.
Ike, omae! Nido to ore no mise ni ashi o fumi ireru nja nai!
Wow, okay. Mad then took a metal pipe that had been nearby and bent it like it was rubber. He threw the pipe and it landed next to me with a heavy thud. The wooden board squeaked under Mad's weight as he returned inside. Well, I guess I fucked up. Catching my breath, I got up while holding my hurt back and rested it against the mad shop sign. I could barely stand. I couldn't make sense of what just happened. Why did Mad do that? What was wrong with my body? Actually, yeah. I feel like I get hurt really, really easily, all things considered. Like, he threw you. Your back's probably not in the greatest shape, but you know. Finally, Shiona came.
Mei, 大丈夫?
After coming closer, she worriedly began rubbing my back.
大丈夫? 怪我ない?
I think the answer would be yes, but am I going to say? No, I'm fine. It's still a bit difficult to breathe, but the pain is slowly going away.
ごめんなさい. 私が目を離した隙にこんなことになってしまって. 大丈夫? 顔真っ青だよ.
Possibly. Maybe that was just my first time experiencing true pain from violence. Maybe that's really what it was. Which would make sense in lots of ways. Hail. I touched my cheeks. They seemed normal to me. Pale would imply a change in blood flow. Do fibroids have blood? How closely are they? I suppose going pale and stuff like that would be natural for them to design if they want them to be real close to humans, but you know. Scary. She was right. I couldn't move because Mad's aggressive demeanor froze me in place. It all made sense. So, that was what fear was like. I do not know. I was just touching that clock. I held my still shaking right hand with my left, as though restraining it. I was interested in how it works, but when I touch it, it seems like I broke it, and... Anger. So, the expression on his face was anger. I learned about an emotion for the first time. Also, I learned that fear accompanies anger. But why did Mad get so angry? There's only one thing I think of. Perhaps I really did break that clock. It was inside his shop, so it must have been Mad's property. Which meant that Mad became angry because I broke something that was his property. Did that mean that I would get angry if something of mine was broken? But I still didn't really understand that feeling. I didn't know what was important to me. Her smile? We've been over that part at least. So of course it hadn't been broken. So that's why I could not understand Mad's anger. Also, I still didn't understand what the emotion was needed for. What was anger necessary for? It's a motivator! If you're gonna talk about, like, human evolution and stuff like that, it's definitely there as a motivator for one. Things that you've come to value, which is another motivator, get violated in some form. Hey, Shiona, what is anger? Well, thanks for indulging me at the very least. You seem quick to not question that I'm asking such a fundamental question. So Mad is always like that. I suppose fiery is a good definition. And his face was certainly red. Doesn't he get tired from being mad all the time? Being angry is important. How so? For behavior that's intimidated one's enemies. But how is that necessary in the relationships binding humans together? It sets boundaries. If you're going to talk about that aspect of it. It sets boundaries for what's okay and what's not. A smile like Shiona's would lead to better relationships than a feeling like that would. It communicates it very quickly. While a smile communicates what's positive. For protecting important things. Yes, that is right. But I thought he was just mad because it broke. Feeling. Shiona gently took my hands into hers as she spoke.
Okay.
Oh, I see. So that's why he... Suddenly, I felt an uneasiness growing in my chest. He's gonna be important. If we have someone who knows how to fix things, we could fix that music box, then we made him an enemy. Yay! It felt terrible. Like something was jabbing me in the chest. Oh, you're feeling guilt. What should I do then? What should I say to Matt? You're assuming I feel guilty. Well, good on you, I guess. Shiona pushed me from behind, and I entered Mad Shop for a second time. From the chair near the register, Mad leaned his head back and looked at me. He gazed at me with the fury of a thousand suns. I felt as though I should just run away. But behind me, I had Shiona. She was there. So, I was able to face him without fleeing. I'm sorry I broke your clock. I struggled even to chuck out that much. Mad stared at me for a few moments, clicked his tongue, and then folded his arms. Not knowing it, I was already backing up, but Shiona reassuringly placed her hand on my back. Thank you, interpreter. I was really taken aback by the fact that his expression and words didn't match at all. No way, he is still mad. Flashback to him, he's like a scowling storm up. I really have no idea what she's talking about. Even then, he looked like he was going to jump out of his chair and sink his fangs into my neck. Well, we have a great first impression of him, don't we? I was shivering in terror, and his tone left me wanting to slink away into the darkness. Right away, Shiona began interpreting for me. Oh, we came here explicitly to break your shit, don't worry. I think you might not actually be interpreting very well. What's that shelf? That didn't seem right at all. There was no way that's what he meant. Shiona, I think you have got it all wrong. Matt is still very angry. Let's just go home already. The fearless Shiona walked right up to Mad.
Konnichiwa, Mando-san. Kyou wa shokuryou o kai ni kitan desu. Osusume wa?
Shokuryou? Kogo ni wa buta no esa shika nei yo. Hora, soko no tana da. Seizei chikushou no you ni kun da na.
Sou desu ka. Doumo arigatou gozaimasu.
Softly smiling, Shiona walked over to the shelf Mad pointed out. You said that he was your friend, right? Is that your interpretation of his words, or is that actually the case? She took out a sliced jerky and a smoked cheese.
Mando-san, soup no zairyou ga hoshii in desu ga.
Soup da? Ii gomibun ni natta mon da. Hora,
Matt then reached under the counter and pulled out a can of food. The can was brand new and it didn't fit with the interior of the shop.
こんなに高級なのよくてに入りましたね。すごく嬉しいです。そんなので喜ぶなんてあわれだな。自分のついでだ。フルーツの缶詰いいんですか？もらっちゃって。せい、ゴミの処分をしてくれるならこっちの都合がいいだけだよ。Holy
shit, he might actually just be the ultimate tsundere.
ありがとうございます。食べ物をいただいたので。
掃除をして帰りますね。掃除はこの間してくれたばっかりだ。その時の分の礼が今日だ。Oh my goodness, he's saying something outright.
でも、それにしてはもらったものが多すぎます。何かお手伝いを。いいって言ってるのが聞こえねえのか。おっとと帰りやがれ。はい、ありがとうございます。また来ますね。
Shiana gave a slight bow to Mad and then left the shop. I left the shop right behind her. I noticed as I was leaving that Mad was glancing at me. But he didn't say anything. I left things at that and departed the shop. No, this is ghost.
チクチクしているけど、とってもいい人だったでしょ?
We'll see. Is he really just soon or... Nah. It started feeling like he was legitimately meaning the opposite of what he was saying out loud at a point, so... When he pulled out the can was the only actual proof of that, though. When he's just like, ah, that's all we have, take what you can get, and then pulls out something entirely different. I guess that might have had some truth to it, considering a can of sliced fruits isn't exactly soup material, is it? I guess I don't really make soup, almost ever. I have no idea if you'd use that in soup. Shiona, was it fun talking to Mad? Oh, I see. No matter how I looked at it, it seemed like they were having two separate conversations. So that was a normal conversation for the two of them. I guess I still had a lot to learn. A feast. Is today an important day or something? I had faint memories on the issue. On a special day or an anniversary, humans had a tradition of celebrating by eating things they normally could not. You know, if I resemble her brother so much, there's a high probability that, bar her brother leaving a very long time ago, a lot of the people in town should recognize me or at least associate my appearance with him. No one has so far, which is interesting. Then again, you might be able to explain some of the behavior by Mad through that, maybe. That's it? Is it really okay to have a feast for that? That seems like hyperbole, but okay. After saying that, Shiona smiled softly. I felt better knowing how much our meeting each other had meant to her. What exactly was the glowing feeling I was getting in my chest? I still didn't understand it. Is there a place to do research around here? This is what I was thinking. The device that moved the hands of the clock was the same as the one that rotated the disc in the music box. So if I could understand that process, maybe I could prepare that music box. Shiona certainly would have been happy if I did that. But in order to do that, I need to learn how. Taking apart a clock and learning that way would have taken too much time. Well, you had a broken clock. You don't necessarily have a too much time. Don't get too impatient. And you have a broken clock that you could be like, can I buy that? And I'll fix it and I'll give it back to you or something like that. I'll use that as a way to learn how to fix things. And for someone who's like, if Mad's important stuff is like, let's take care of the stuff we have, I think he'd probably be like, you want to learn how to fix things? Yeah,
I could get behind that.
Besides, I didn't have any tools. Okay, yeah, that's right. Man might have some extra extras, though. Even if I did have them, I might have ended up breaking it again. I want a quick and reliable method to repair the music box. Don't get impatient. Therefore, the most efficient option was to acquire professional knowledge. Yeah, okay. That's not exactly a bad option, either. Yeah, if there's a place you know, please tell me. After thinking a bit, Shiona gave her answer. Really? Okay. A library. Only the name rang a bell. Like the camera film, this was a prior era sculpture. Libraries are a thing of the past. I'm not going to completely disagree, but I grew up when libraries were still a notable thing that still existed. You, like, had to go there for some things still. Like, they phased out as I grew up, like, as a realistic place that you went to often, in comparison to the internet and whatnot, but, you know, they're still relevant for various reasons. Well, I know they, like, got to the point where they're, like, they have androids and whatnot, so they're probably long past that and whatnot, but it's funny to hear libraries as this antique thing. Libraries were facilities where they stored books made of paper. As far as I remembered, they weren't places that average people could access easily, since they were made to preserve the culture. Yeah. Also, using a database connection to do research was much more efficient.
Ta-da.
What's wrong? Is something the matter? How dare they? A girl. So she's sad. A sad smile formed on his face. Blue. I reasoned that blue meant a lack of positive feelings. Regardless, I desperately wanted to repair that music box and make Shiona happy. Can I ask you to guide me there, to the library? Shiona paused a bit to think. What's wrong? Something is really bothering you, huh? Shiona immediately started to lead me to the library. I took half the groceries Shiona had brought and followed behind her. For some reason, the two of us splitting this work made the inside of my chest feel ticklish. Okay, are we going straight to the library? Okay, that's probably a good place to end this. I wanted to do a particularly long episode because I'm probably not going to do an extra one, because typically I try to do two episodes to start, but this is really interesting. Again, it sounds like it's normally $10. It's also $5 on sale for at least when I picked this up initially. It said that it was ending basically the day that I expect to post this. So it's really interesting so far. It's not supposed to be that long either. So, you know, go pick it up. Yeah. If you haven't already and you've already gotten to this point, highly recommend it. I'll reiterate that and I'll shut up about it from now on. I'm curious what direction it'll take. At the very least, it's not, again, it's not supposed to be that long from my understanding, so we're spending a lot of time on the internal turmoil, I suppose, would be one way to phrase it, though that might be excessive in terms of implications of our main character, Ray, here. Either way, I really like it. I think the music's nice, I think the setting is interesting and vague enough, and there's a lot of things that are being sort of played close to the chest and offered information on a vague sense that there's a lot to play around with speculation-wise, so it's very interesting in terms of what's going on in the world, what's going to happen with the characters. The characters are interesting too, Shiona in particular. I don't think I've ever seen a character that had that sort of quirk where they try to describe the world in terms of colors. The more I hear it, the more I feel as though it's not that thing that I'm blanking on the name of where you experience different senses, like, with another sense. I don't think it's that. It doesn't really add up if it's supposed to be that, because it's just sort of, like, describing things as part of color instead. So I would say the thing about key stories that I found is that they tend to play with your emotions pretty significantly. I'm not one to cry. There's been a few times over the course of the games I've played on the channel where I've teared up and stuff like that, but there's only been one case consuming any sort of media where I just cried and could not stop myself. And that was Kalinada After Story. So that holds, like I said, I'm not a sentimental person. That really does hold a special place for me. For various reasons. Good and bad in some senses, so it's a bit more of a nuanced feeling about it. But in general, the stuff from Key that I've watched, or I suppose not read, this would be the first time I've done a visual novel of their stuff, they've always been very sad at some point or another. Or a very sad feeling, and there's drama more than just, you know, stuff, so I can't help but feel as though things are gonna go wrong in some fashion, and I'm not exactly, like, not looking forward to that, but I'm also, you know, not looking forward to that, you know? So yes, I'm gonna leave it there. Expect, like, the normal hour episodes until I finish this, and then I'll go back to Majikoi, which I'm doing this in between routes, basically, as a break from it. So, I'll see you all next time. I hope you enjoyed it. I'm certainly probably going to enjoy it, regardless of how many people are actually interested in the series on the channel. So, I'll see you all next time. Drive safely, everyone.